Thank you so much, Ankur, for doing this for me.
It's a pleasure, Suparna. Thank you so much for having me.
So first things first, what does entrepreneurship mean to you?
I like the question. For me, entrepreneurship is definitely not a profession. I consider it as a mindset.
Okay.
And I often speak about the fact that to be an entrepreneur, you don't need to be owning a business. You don't need to have a startup. You don't need to have equity and so on. It's how you think about life.
Okay.
Which is not taking the status quo as the reality. So you're always challenging yourself. You're always thinking of whether what you have in front of you can be better designed, better reproduced, looked at again. You're never bothered about the 10,000 reasons why you shouldn't do something, but always driven by the one reason why you will succeed.
Right.
And you have the ability to get a tribe working towards that singular goal.
Right.
At least I know, because I came from a corporate background and then became an entrepreneur, that I somehow felt that I was always an entrepreneur at heart and in mind. So even when I was working for someone else, I approached things very differently. And that's the feedback I got from my bosses, from my first managers.
To take responsibility for whatever you're doing.
Absolutely. And just to reimagine how things are. Because India has this aise hi hoti hain cheeze wala approach. But if someone comes in and says, ki aise kyun hoti hai? Why does it need to be this way? You suddenly start challenging things. And you know, if you build a cult around it, if you build a tribe around it, then that's potentially an entrepreneur. Now, I'm blessed that I've taken it to the last mile, where I'm blessed to have this company and so on.
Sure.
But for me, it's more of a mindset.
I'm glad you mentioned this, because unfortunately, the buzzword around as far as startups is concerned, everybody talks about valuation. Before you've actually launched your product or your idea or whatever it is, people are already getting into the kind of monies that they're going to raise.
Yeah.
What do you feel about that?
I know it'll be a little hypocritical for me to say anything against it, because I'm part of the bandwagon.
Sure.
But if I were to be honest, I think in the last 2 to 3 years, raising money suddenly became very fashionable when it didn't need to. I always stand by the fact that the social responsibility of a business is to make profits.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are suddenly feeling that having awesome offices and having raised money is your claim to fame and not the true business that you've built and the ability for it to make money, you're definitely going down the wrong path.
So what is it that you look for, you know, as an entrepreneur yourself or as an investor? What do you look for in an idea?
For me, there are essentially three things. The first and the most important thing is the market that you want to play in. People misunderstand the fact that a team can overcome a market, but I think that a bad team can still do well in a good market.
Achcha.
But a good team cannot ever do well in a bad market. And when I say market, I don't mean the sentiment. I mean, what's the opportunity you're going after?
Mm-hmm.
My first experience as an entrepreneur taught me the reality that a lot of problems that we think are problems in India are not really problems.
Okay.
We think they are because, you know, we these snooty people who are sitting in our air-conditioned cabins and think that there is a problem outside in the offline world and so on. But when you genuinely deep dive, you figure that it isn't really a problem.
Mm.
Simple example, when we started Gaadi.com, which was my first venture, we figured that the process of buying and selling used cars was a pain in India.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have to go into the sweltering heat and you have to figure out what car you want and so on. But we figured it's actually a very efficient process, because if you had a budget in mind and you wanted to buy a used car, the network was so well established that all they had to do was just pick up the phone, and within half an hour you would have options in front of you.
Sure.
And then bringing that online was just a fashionable way. It wasn't solving any problem.
Right.
It was just fashionable to say, oh, we bought the entire process online.
Okay.
But it's generally not a problem.
But it can be scaled up further, right? From one portion,
Absolutely. And that brings me, and I'm glad you mentioned that, that brings me to the second thing, which is, once you've identified a problem, how big is that problem and how many people are impacted by it? Is it a problem that is only your problem? So it's again fashionable to say, scratch your own itch.
Correct.
If you have a problem, then start on that. I am not an ambassador of that, because I feel that if you are just thinking of your own problem, you get consumed by it and most likely blinded by it.
Right.
Think of the problem from a true sense of it. How many people are genuinely impacted by this problem?
That's interesting that you mentioned this, Ankur, because I've been, you know, talking to a lot of people, and The sentiment that I got is that in the idea, the person, again, scratch your own itch. If you are not really a true believer, sure, or it doesn't affect you somewhere or the other, you may tend to deviate after a while, because entrepreneurship is not an easy ball game,
exactly,
right? You've got to be committed to it for a very long period of time.
Exactly.
So how would you address that?
I think what you're saying is right to a large extent, that perseverance and commitment to that idea is perhaps the single biggest thing that an entrepreneur brings in. But that doesn't necessarily need to be from get-go. At least personally speaking, I have fallen in love with the ideas I started working in.
Okay.
I wasn't married to them from day one.
Okay.
I've grown to appreciate them, I've grown to respect them. And there were enough occasions where I spent enough time and figured this wasn't good enough and I don't want to do it any further. At least personally, I'm proud about the fact that I don't delve into the time that I've spent on doing something as the reason why I should continue doing it.
Okay.
So if I have worked on something and at some point of time it stops making sense, I will cut it and I'll move on to doing something else. That's how I've lived my life, and I'm happy that I have. But that gives me the flexibility to just deep dive into something and over time see if I fall in love with that idea. Nearby is a great example. When I started the Groupon business in 2011, I had very little appreciation for what it takes for people to step out and consume the offline world.
Okay.
I used to do it as a consumer when you step into the mall and so on.
Sure.
But thinking of how does the entire decision happen in the consumer's mind? How do they decide where to go and eat? How do they decide where to go and shop? Which movie to watch? How soon do they do it from the time when they actually step out and so on?
Mm-hmm.
That's something that I grew to respect and appreciate over time.
Mm-hmm.
And once I did, I was completely consumed by it. Because now I just spend all my energy thinking about how can we make this process of stepping out more and more efficient.
So whose idea was Nearby?
Well, I wouldn't call it anyone's idea, because the Groupon started in 2008 in the US, in Chicago. And their idea was very simple, that people love to save money. And when they step out in groups, there is a possibility for merchants to give a discount because there is guaranteed sales. That was a simple premise.
Got it.
Then it exploded across the world. And I think over time, when I spent time into the space and I built the Groupon India business, I figured that there needed to be a very different twist in the Indian context, which is there's so many options in front of us, right? From the Thela Wala down the street to the fine dining place that you can go to. And it becomes a massive choice game for the consumer.
Hmm.
Where should I go and eat, or what should I do with my time and money?
Right.
I have time to kill and I want to meet my friends. So should I go to an entertainment parlor? Should I go for a movie? Should I go and drink? So on and so forth. And that problem then started consuming us, which is what eventually became Nearby.
Ankur, you mentioned the impact of the idea and the number of people that it is affecting. How important, according to you, is a value system woven into the DNA of an idea? I'm not talking about social impact or maybe even gender equity, you know, but just the culture, or just, you know, how you actually do business.
I'm so glad you asked this question, Suparna. It's rare people ask it, and I don't know why. I am an extremely strong believer in that. I think it's very easy for startups to grow and be on this fast pace and have these cool offices and have this nice infrastructure and get all the nice, happy colleges, students to work for them and so on. But when shit happens, the only thing that prevents the startup is the value system.
Okay.
In fact, not the startup. When bad things happen, the only thing that keeps you grounded, whether
right,
it's family, whether it's relationships, whether it's company, is the value system. And it is shocking to me how that value system is missing from so many establishments that I come across every day.
Right.
They speak of it, but they don't endorse it.
Hmm.
It's not visible all across. And it doesn't need to be superfluous. It doesn't need to be all that poster and Steve Jobs level pay.
Slogans.
Very functional, yeah, straightforward. So I'll give you a simple example. At Nearby, our value system is defined by three words that we live and breathe by every day: respect, ownership, and performance.
Okay.
So we are absolutely of the opinion that everyone is equal. There doesn't need to be hierarchies built into the system. There doesn't need to be sir and ma'ams being there. Respect is earned by conduct and not by title, which is why you'll see the office is absolutely flat. There is no CEO aage, or manager aage, so on and so forth. everyone's respected. When we go for offsites, we take everyone along, including our office boys.
Right.
Everyone drinks the same liquor, everyone dances to the same music, everyone stays in the same room and so on and
right.
so forth.
So if Ankur is making the buck, so is everybody else.
Absolutely.
And when Ankur stops making the buck, it's not that he is the only one who will take away all the monies and the rest of the guys will be sent a letter to say go back home.
Exactly.
That's what
exactly.
we're seeing, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're 253 people. And 237 of them have shares in the company.
Acha.
So we're very generous with that. We want everyone to grow and
right.
get that done. Ownership, same thing. Performance, same thing. So these three words, very simply put, define the cultural ethos of this company. And every decision that we take, if it conflicts with either of these three, is never taken.
Tell me three steps to success. What would they be?
Well, that's, I wish I knew, because then things would be different for us as well. I'd like to believe these would be the three steps to success. One is to always be honest and transparent. It's a rarity to find nowadays.
Is that prevalent? That's what I'm going to ask you.
It's
in
not.
India and the ecosystem that we're in, and especially we're so familiar with the word jugaad,
yeah.
cutting corners,
yeah.
stepping on toes.
Yeah, I don't like those things. So, no, the unfortunate reality of India is we are all a result of a billion people and very limited opportunities.
Right.
And thus, an education or a value system that told us you will only be successful if you are able to trample someone else. You're not going to win because you're smart. You're going to win because someone else lost.
Wow.
And that's how our schools have taught us. That's how, unfortunately, engineering entrance exams are all about
wow.
and medical exams are all about. Key. On that exam day, it doesn't matter how good you are because there's so many of you that everyone can be good. So you almost have to pray that the topper has fallen sick because that's the way you win.
Right.
And that sentiment is very anti, say, the valley, where people are like, you only grow when you hold hands and move together. It's not, unfortunately, the case here. So I feel that in the context of India, if you have the ability to be genuinely honest and transparent in your conduct, you suddenly have a cutting edge. It places you in a high pedestal, which is very hard to stand by,
right.
very hard to live by.
Correct.
But should you be able to do it, you are in the top order already.
Already, okay.
And that at least has helped us a lot. Now, in our conversations, we are, anything that is happening, whether we're running out of money, whether we have enough money, whether we're facing a genuine problem or something else, everything is known to the company at all points of
so
time.
So honesty, you'd
honesty
put that,
and transparency,
okay,
that number
and transparency.
One. Number two is perseverance. And perseverance does not mean irrational optimism. It means that you know that you're on the right path and you're not allow anyone else to disturb your conviction as long as you're convinced.
Okay.
Which is very different from irrational optimism, ki yaar, nahi, ho jayega, ho jayega, karte rehte hain, ho jayega. I see enough
Chalta
entrepreneurs
hai.
Ki 2 saal fight maar diya, 1 saal aur maarte hain. That for me becomes foolish, because if you're true to yourself, which is the honesty bit, then you wouldn't lie and say, yeah, nahin, it's not working out, let me not be a fool and just move on. So perseverance, which is, there are enough people in India, generally anywhere else, who will always discourage you.
Correct.
Will always say, yeah, chod, why are right. you doing this? You can easily get a job, you're smart, you have this,
correct.
You're this, you're that,
sure.
why? People will give you 10,000 reasons why you should fail, but you need that one reason why you will succeed.
Correct.
That's very important.
Yeah.
And then the third thing for me, which is supremely critical, is that you're always able to find, I wouldn't call it a family, but a team that knows how to work together. So one big angst that I have is it's fashionable again to call your startup a family. But the minute I start calling my startup a family, I cannot do a lot of things that I would want to do. I don't fire my dad because he's not a good dad.
Correct.
I don't hold my sister accountable for being the best
How
sister.
Wonderful is that? I mean, I don't think anybody or a lot of people think about it like that. If
yeah.
you have something which is a dysfunction probably within your team, you don't just go ahead and say, okay, it's like a rebellious child.
Yeah, exactly, right? So I want a professional team. I want to have a meaningful conversation with people saying, look, we're all in this because we're professionals. We're in this because we are meant to bring something valuable. And the day we stop doing that, we're going to have a conversation about it.
Right.
And but it's in your best interest to be at the best of your talent. It's in my best interest to provide you with that opportunity, and let's make that work, which is a very different.
My next question, in terms of the importance of co-founders in any enterprise.
I do not know how single founders work. Like it's a hats off to them. I have the highest level of respect, but I am just not that person. For me, the founders that I have here, I cannot imagine doing this without them. It's a blessing that we connect so well, that it's not just about work. We bond beyond work. Our families know each other. We hang out together. We go on vacations together. We share a lot of our lives.
But it looks
together.
Like things are going all right. But when yeah. the going
exactly.
isn't so good.
And I think it's people ask me, yeah, I'm looking for a co-founder. Where should I find one? And I'm like, the question is equivalent to, I'm looking for a wife. Where should I find
one? Right.
How can I even answer that question?
Right.
You are, in fact, I would say finding a co-founder is harder because you're possibly going to spend 10, 12 hours with that individual for the next 3 to 5 years at least. Mm. You need to be intellectually, emotionally, maturely married into that person. Mm. Mm. And that's a very, very hard thing. And understandably, things don't work out. And there are differences, there are clashes, there are of opinions, of egos and whatnot. Mm. The startup then suffers because of it. I've seen enough cases.
What would be the 3 dysfunctions that lead to, a collapse of an enterprise or not maybe living up to its full potential?
In no particular order, I would say that first, the leadership not being aligned, for sure.
Okay.
I wouldn't necessarily call it just the founders, but there is some sort of a lack of chemistry between the leadership that inhibits their ability to execute. That's number one. Number two is struggling to find what's fancily called the product market fit, which is, what you've built, is there enough market for that? Enough consumers are willing to, pay for it? Enough consumers who want that product? If that is not established, then you're just smoking your own Kool-Aid. You're like, "Haan, maine bana diya," and everyone wants it because you think you've made it and
Correct.
Everyone wants it, but no one really wants it. No one cares, which is the second thing.
Which is the litmus test of whatever your idea is.
Absolutely, absolutely. And there's so many ways of doing that. And I think the one mistake that people make is they assume that the litmus test is something that happens right in the beginning and it happens fast. And if it does, then you have to scale.
Hmm.
I'll be the first one to admit that even after 2 years of Nearby, we still haven't found the exact product that needs to work to make this happen.
Wow.
So we're still working our way through, and we're more than happy to sign up for that process because it's not going to be easy. And if we do dream of being a very large setup where every dollar in the offline world flows through us, it's foolish for us to expect that it's going to happen in months and it'll take years.
Mm.
I use this anecdote. I say, if you're thinking of going out for dinner this evening and you're planning to spend an hour on that, how much time would you spend in selecting the place that you want to go to?
Mm.
And people generally say 5-10 minutes. I says, okay, great. So you're saying that you would spend about 1/6 of the time in just finding or researching about the place you want to go through. Now, if you intend to work for 6 years on your startup, why would you not spend a year in just trying to figure out what you want to do?
Right. So Nearby is still figuring out?
We're still figuring out. We're nowhere close. And I hope we never are, because that keeps us anxious, that keeps us ahead of everyone else, that just keeps us worried that we have to crack this because someone else might, and we might lose the game, and we love that pressure on us.
Growth versus profitability.
Very hard one, but if I were to just pick, I would say growth in the early years, because you have to establish yourself, you have to get to a point where this is making sense and there's a flywheel effect. Once you get to that point, profitability. But with a very strong caveat that profitability is usually spoken about the true profit of the company, which is after you've paid for all the costs and everything and so on. But the important metric of profitability is what's called unit economics profitability, which is at every transaction level. Are you losing money or are you making money?
Okay.
Because if you're losing money at a transaction level, then what's the hope in hell that you'll ever make money?
Right.
If you make money at the transaction level, but not enough to cover your fixed costs, your salary, your offices, and
sure.
so on, that's pardonable. Mm. Because in the early years, no one's expecting you to do that. But to live or execute a business where you're not even making money on every transaction, then you're essentially selling under cost.
Mm.
Now, you're buying something for 100 and selling it for 90. What's the business is that? Anyone can do that. It's literally like paying 10 bucks to someone and getting a customer.
Correct, right.
But if you get something for 100 and sell it for 110, but that 10 rupees is not enough to cover for your salary and your fixed costs, you're still okay. Because eventually you'll make enough tens to cover for that.